So today we called this day Vision Sunday. And part of the reason we called it that is because the AGM is a little later on today. Can anyone say woot woot? That was a stretch for some. We made it, though. Stretch for myself, even. But AGM is right after this. And some people think, oh, AGM, boring, lame-o, I don't want to go, it's whatever. Sometimes they're stressful for a lead pastor. What are people going to ask? Where are we going to get? But I'll tell you, I'm so excited for our AGM because when we look back on this year, it's incredible to see what God has done. The work that has happened in this church is so, it's just fun. I love talking about it. I don't get to talk about it to all of you all the time. And so if you're a member, come out today because it's full of vision. It's full of excitement and we need you. And if you're not a member, you're still welcome to be here and part of it. After the second service, there's some soup. We're going to stick around here. Soup and sandwich or just soup? Oh, soup and a bun. And then we'll be back in here for AGM. It's going to be fun. And so since that was happening, just in staff meeting this last week, we really felt like we're going to start a series next week called Road to Recovery. But we felt like we need to put that off 1 week, and I just want to talk to you about vision for this church, about where we're going. We've come a long way, and now where are we going? And I think that's really important for you to hear from me because my mind is always rolling. I'm always thinking about where are we going and what's it going to look like and how are we going to get there and Lord, what do you want in this season and what can we expect and what are the immeasurable things beyond what we can ever expect or imagine? What are those things that are going to happen? And so that's always on my heart, and I just want to share a little bit of that with you as well right now. We, in this last couple of years, by the way, today is my 2-year anniversary at this church. I showed up here actually March 8th. Kendall and I, that was our first Sunday, but it was AGM Sunday, the first Sunday of March. I guess that would be the second Sunday of March. But anyways, the closest Sunday to this Sunday. And so we've now been here 2 years. And in those 2 years, it has been a whirlwind. I can't believe it's been 2 years because there's so much has happened and just like it just feels like we've been, lots has been going on. And I'm just really excited to tell you, our church has grown a lot in these last couple of years. Our small groups have grown a lot. Our giving has grown a lot. We've seen a lot of growth, a lot of development. Our worship team has grown a lot. Our guest services teams have grown a lot. We've seen our kids team develop a lot. We've got a second service. Like a lot has happened in those times. As people start to ask me, because they hear about how Northgate is growing and what's going on there, and I have people that are asking me, so at what point do you sort of level out, you know? Because you've been going like this, and that can't really be that sustainable, probably. If you're always growing, then you're probably, like, that's going to be hard to handle, and it's not going to work, and I'm not sure that you'll have the right staffing, or the right people, or the right team, or the right infrastructure, or whatever, to support that. So at what point do you kind of level out, and at what point do you just kind of settle down a little bit, and settle into who you are? When do you plateau? This week, I sat down with our pastors. Our pastoral team has a meeting each week around vision, and we've been working through something called natural church development, which has been something. Some people took a survey last fall, and we've been just studying, and how do we step into that survey results and look into what we do now as a church. And one of the things that hit me this week is he said, there is no such thing as plateauing in ministry. In church ministry, there's no such thing as plateauing. He said, you're always either planting seeds of fruitfulness or seeds of fruitlessness. One of the two is always happening. You can't just level out and carry on as it is. You can't just get to where you like it and then say, we're good, we like this, let's just stay here and do this. What we're doing now feels good to all of us, and let's just stick around and keep it this way. It doesn't work. We're either growing or we're moving towards shrinking. We're either reaching more or we're protecting what we have, which eventually causes us to be dying off. We're not here to protect this. We're not here as Christians to protect a church feeling or a church culture that we have. We're not here to protect the worship, how it feels, or the lighting, what it looks like, or the sound, or the lobby, what goes on in there, or how many services we have, or what. We're not here to protect those things. What we're here to do is reach more people. And as we reach more people, that will be the culture of this church. The culture of this church will actually be built on us going to others, on us looking for others, on us reaching for others, on us trying for others, which means our culture will always be changing because new people will come in and they bring a different flavor and a different element and they have a different eye and we're going to hear different things and it's going to feel a little bit different. And when people come to know Jesus, does anyone know when someone knows Jesus for the first time, they're just a little bit excited? And I don't know if you've seen that person, you know, that sort of sits in their chair like this. They come to both services and then ask if we can do a third that day, or, you know, hey, I'll be here for both and I'll stick around. You need coffee? I'll do coffee. I'll take care of this. And, you know, these are the exciting people. I love when those people are in our church. When people don't quite get the structure of things, don't quite understand when to sit and when to stand and what they're supposed to do in a Sunday morning. I love that culture. And when we try to protect the culture we have instead of expecting that it's going to change because we're reaching, we start to die off. We start to have less significance. God has always wanted us to be missional. He's always wanted us to reach out. He's always wanted us to look outside of us. He's always wanted us to call in those who are far from Him. He's always wanted us to discover the ones who don't know Him yet and help them to know Him. Therefore, our culture will change to reach them. Not to please us, not just to please the people who are in the seats already, because the church isn't for Christians only. The church is Christians for the world. We exist here for those who aren't here. We don't exist here for just us. We just had a members meeting, and we have 20 new members coming on, and I actually said in that members meeting, guys, If you're wanting to join membership so that you can decide how Sunday mornings look, and so that you can tell us what songs we need to play, and so that you can make sure that we do the services a certain way and the lighting a certain way and do all that stuff, I said you probably just shouldn't be members. Because coming on to membership isn't about you all of a sudden getting your preferences met. Coming into membership is saying I'm committed to the mission of not worrying about my preferences as much as worrying about reaching the people who are out there. And that's the point of who we are as a church. That's what we're all about in this church. That's what we're always going to be all about. This is sometimes hard for people. When Jesus showed up on the earth, he had a pretty interesting mission. He showed up and he sort of lived his life until he was 30 years old. He learned a lot. He grew a lot. He spent some time with older, more experienced people and understood things that he hadn't understood before. And he walked life out like that for a long time. It says he grew in wisdom, favor, and stature. And as he grew along, eventually it was time for him to start his ministry. And everyone was shocked to whom his ministry was focused. Because everyone thought that once he finally started his ministry and got going, he was going to go to all the people who knew a lot, and he was going to affirm everything that all the really religious people had taught and had done, because they knew how to follow the law. And since they knew how to follow the law, if any good religious person was going to do anything of impact in this planet, they better just do the law. And since the Pharisees were already doing the law fully and perfectly, he better just follow what they do. And Jesus, 30 years old, gets baptized. The Holy Spirit comes, is involved. Then he gets tempted. He defeats the enemy in that time. He defeats Satan in that time. And then he starts doing ministry. And the very first ministry he starts doing are to people that no one else wants to do ministry for. He starts looking for the poor and the blind and the deaf, and the ones who aren't actually, like the ones who everyone else thought must be sinners, because nothing bad happens to you unless you've sinned. And if you sin, then your body is going to fall apart and you're going to lose your vision, or you're going to you're being punished by God if you have any ailments like that. And Jesus just starts walking around and saying, hey, actually, God wants to heal you. Boom, boom. He starts healing all these people, all these others who have rejected and even persecuted some of those who have been trying to follow God up until this point. Jesus is going up to them. He's going up to those of different races and different ethnicities and those who've opposed the Jews. He's going up to everyone. He's just saying, hey, listen, the kingdom of God is near. And it's me. And I want to bring you healing. And I want to bring you life. And I want to bring you joy. And those who've been part of the religious order for a long time are saying, that doesn't really fit with us. And I want to read a story that's been on my heart for this day that captures this moment. It's in Luke 15. Luke 15, 1 to 32, it says, now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. I love that. Jesus is doing his ministry, and now he's drawing a crowd. The crowd he's drawing are the sinners. People who were not like Jesus liked Jesus. And Jesus liked people who were not like him. And he's doing all this ministry, and all these sinners are coming like, hey, tell us more. We want to know about it. And all these religious teachers are like, wait a second, you haven't come to any of my speeches. Like, you haven't even listened to anything that I've had to say. And I've told you how to live. I've told you all the good things that you should do. And if you do them, then you can have the blessing of God. And you haven't come to hear any of that. So why are you coming to hear him? But Jesus is walking around. Sounds good. Come on in, guys. Yeah. Gather in. I've got something to say. Here it is. The kingdom of God is coming. Repent. Turn your life over to me, to Jesus, to the Father, and you will know him. You will experience him. You will feel him. You will know the life that he gives. And so just come on in. And so they keep coming in droves. They're showing up. Wait. You're healing people? Well, I need some healing. Wait. You're telling people they can be forgiven? Well, I need to be forgiven. You're telling people that they can repent and turn to you, and that's all they need. Okay, well, I need that. And they all start gathering around Jesus. It's quite a spectacle. I sometimes try to imagine what this group of people looked like. Very different than what it looked like when the Pharisees spoke. When everyone was good and proper and figured out, and they had protected the culture that they had up until that point. And everyone was sorted. It says, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. I like that. This man welcomes sinners and eats with them. Not only does he let them come to him, he changes the course of his day so he can stop and eat with them and hear their stories. Those who were following Jesus and had a plan of what things were going to look like would have had such a hard time with it. No, Jesus, aren't we going this way? Yeah, we will, but this guy, it's okay. Yeah, sure, we like you, guy, you're nice, but we're going and we've got something to do. And Jesus is like, well, why don't we just go ahead and grab a falafel with them. Like, let's just take a second. Sits down and, hey, tell me your story. Tell me what's up. Tell me the areas in your life where you're hopeless. Tell me where you're broken. Tell me where things are feeling like you can't get past them. I want to know your life. And have you heard of my father? Would you like to follow him? When Jesus heard them saying this, he told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me. I have found my lost sheep. I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. He said, listen, Jesus isn't very fair here. It's not like, okay, it'll be about equal if one to one. No, he says, if 99 of you have your life sorted out, if 99 of you are following Jesus and you're living that life and you're giving your life over and you're doing well, if we have 99 committed Christians in Northgate Foursquare Church, Jesus is going to and heaven is going to rejoice more when one person turns their life over than if 99 of us just show up to church. Isn't that a crazy thought? Well, that's not fair. There's 99 of us. We're all here. We've committed ourselves. We've given our lives. We're showing up every week. We're on worship. We smile at the door. We don't even want to. You know? We serve coffee to people who aren't very thankful. We speak or we do announcements or we do whatever it is that our role is here. We do all of these things. Shouldn't you rejoice over us, Jesus? And Jesus says, heaven rejoices more for the one who comes in the door than the 99 who are already there. Isn't that crazy? Come on, Jesus. What about us? Yeah, you're great. Let's go get them. You're great, let's go, but there's someone lost. You're found, but there's someone out there who's not here yet. You're already at the party. Let's go find some more people and bring them into the party. There's something special that I want them to be a part of that you're saying you are a part of. Why would we rejoice at you being here when there's some that still need to be got? Jesus says, let's go get them. I love that. Next, he says, or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the whole house, search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me! I have found my lost coin! In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. One person who gives their life, one person who turns over their life and says, I'm done living the way I was, I want to live this way. One person, there's rejoicing that happens. And then finally, Jesus gets into this last parable, which I feel like we could talk about every single week, and we wouldn't talk about it enough. Jesus continued, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and then squandered his wealth in wild living. So this son, this father has two sons, and one son says, Dad, I don't really care to work for you anymore, and I don't really want to wait till you're dead. That's a long time. I'm in my prime right now. This is where I'm going to really be able to live it up, so I don't want to wait till you're dead to get your money. So instead, just pretend you're dead. I'll act like you're dead, and you give me half your money, and I'll go live it up. Sound good, Dad? And his dad, in this gracious act, says, okay, I love you, son. You go. His son goes, says he squandered it on wealth, all this wealth on wild living. After he had spent everything there was, a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but not one gave him anything. No one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and he went to his father. I really love this story. Here's Jesus. By the way, the whole chapter before this is in Luke is Jesus talking about a banquet and a feast and who should be invited to that feast and who should be honored at those feasts. And if people are too busy for him, who else he should bring into that feast. And he's talking about all of this stuff, really helping people recognize that it's not some elite club that gets to hang out with Jesus, but it's the lowest of the lowest. It's the famous to the nameless. It's everyone. They all get a piece of it if they want it. They all get Jesus if they want it. And then here he comes and the Pharisees say, now what is he doing eating with all these sinners and all of these bad people and taking all his time? And Jesus tells these two stories and then he says, let me sort of finish this off. There's a father and he gives away his inheritance to his son. His son goes and squanders it all. And everyone would just be like, oh, I can't believe it. This guy shamed his whole family, shamed his dad, shamed the one who loved him. His dad gave him all this grace to send him off. And his son had already basically said, let's pretend you're dead so I get what would be coming to me if you were dead. And but now all of a sudden the son has lived a terrible life, has spent it all on himself, has had all of these great, nice, happy moments until sin caught up with him and he couldn't afford that lifestyle anymore. And now he has the nerve to come back to his dad. Who does he think his dad is? Some sort of fool who's going to be walked all over? No. Don't accept him back, Dad. The Pharisees would have been saying that. Don't accept him back, Dad. What will the city say? What will the community say? What will the people say? Don't do it. What happens when you let people back like that into your life? What happens when they come around? Okay, if he's going to come back into your house, then you better give him the lowest of the low position so everyone knows where he stands. So that everyone knows the person that he is. So everyone knows the mess up that he's been. Make sure he's in the lowest position that you can find so that everyone knows who he is. Well, as he's walking there, trying to figure out what to say to his dad. It says, while he was still a long way off. I wonder if anyone here knows someone who's a long way off from the Lord. If anyone knows someone who's a long way off figuring out how to live the right life, figuring out how to make church and put on their church clothes and put on their church smile. And put on all the proper. I wonder if you know anyone who's a long way off from fitting into this culture. And I wonder if we're too busy protecting a culture sometimes than looking for the long way offer, finding them. It says, while he was a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. Then the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. And he wasn't. Speaking truth. That's true, he wasn't. You're not good enough to be called my son. In fact, you said I was dead. In fact, I'm a laughingstock of our community ever since you left. In fact, our community has been telling me that when you come back, I need to make sure you know where you fit in this family now. You know where you fit in this city now. You know where you fit in society now. Everyone else knows where you fit, so I need to make sure I show you where you fit in this society. Instead, it says that the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe. Not the average robe, but the best robe, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. I love this. I never want to lose this in church. I never want to lose this passion in church that the Father has for the lost son. As soon as we do, we've plateaued, and we'll soon shrink. As long as we have this passion, And we're willing to give up anything. We're willing to leave the 99 to reach the one. We're willing to put aside the 9 coins to find the one. We're willing to put aside the one son to welcome the one. As long as we do that, this church has no limit to how it can reach this community. That God will do incredible things through this place as we look a long way off. Find the ones who are a long way off and go and give them a royal welcome. Wow. It says, meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. Wow. What is it? Did they finally give me what I deserve? I finally get the party that, I mean, I've been serving so long for my dad. I've been working so long on the field. I sweat every day. I poured blood, sweat, and tears into this place. Did I finally get what I deserve? Do you know one of the quickest ways for us to slow the growth of a church is for all of us who are part of the church to decide that the church is for us and that it needs to serve us. If the church is only here to serve us Christians, then it'll never serve those who aren't. If we're just sitting here trying to figure out how to be the big brother and make sure, when am I going to get my party? Because I've worked hard, and I've poured my life into this, and I've given time into this. I've got up early and read the Bible. I've been part of prayer groups. I've served hosting. I've led a small group. I've been on worship team. I've done all of these things. All I ask is that you would just play my favorite song in the worship set. You know, that's all I need. Just play my favorite song. That's all. Just do it my way. That's all I'm asking. Just do it how I want it. And we start doing, okay, sure. We'll do it for you. Oh, and you too? Yeah, we'll do it for you. And we'll make you happy. Okay, are all the Christians feeling pretty happy? And are we all feeling like we've got ourselves sorted and everyone's feeling like we found a nice comfortable place for us to reside and protect? Okay, now let's shut the doors and not let anyone in and come and mess it up. Because we need our space. Our space is in heaven. It's not here. The harder we try to make this our space, the harder we'll push to keep others out. Instead, we're going to party when they come in from a long way off, and we welcome them. The older brother came home, or he heard music and dancing, so he called one of the servants and asked him, "So what's going on? Should I wear my tux or what? What's happening around here?" "Oh, your brother? Oh, good, did he die? Are we partying about that? Yeah, okay, good. Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back, safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in, so his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat, like one of the chewy ones. You never gave me any of it so I could celebrate with my friends." I've got friends too. Just give me some of the smoked meat, like whatever. I'll take a hamburger patty. You've never done anything for me. "But when this son of yours, who has squandered, by the way, have you forgotten who he is? He's the bad one. He hasn't done good things. He's been a bit of a clown for the last bunch of years. He brought shame on our family, has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home. You kill the fattened calf for him." And he says, "My son, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." I want to build a culture in this church where we have the same concept that all we have to do is celebrate when the lost come and find Jesus. He says we had to celebrate. The father knew. I knew this was going to offend you, son. I knew you've worked hard for this, son. I knew that, but we have to celebrate. He's home. He was away. And he goes, yeah, well, I didn't want him home. Because he comes home and the whole family cares about him and they forget about me. I want to be remembered for once in my life. I want to be known for once in my life. I want to be thought about for once in my life. I want to be partied for and celebrated for once in my life. I'm sitting here working hard. When am I going to get mine? And the dad says, you always have had it. But your son, your brother was gone and he's home. Will you come be part of the party with us? No, I won't. I won't. You know, every time a church has decided to build their structure and their systems and their purposes, their staff around reaching those who are far from Jesus, every time that decision is made, there are people who will say, I don't want to be part of that church because it doesn't feel like what my church felt like at this point. Or I don't feel like I get treated with special respect for being a long-term Christian. Or I don't feel like they recognize this or that about me. Or I don't feel like they do things in a way that would honor 50 years ago church. I just don't feel like they're doing it that way. Every time that's going to be the case. And for us, what we're going to do is we're going to be fighting to be the father on this Vision Sunday. Where we're saying, all we're doing, we're not kicking you out. We're not asking anyone to be outside of this party. In fact, we're inviting you in. But the party will be around not the longest serving Christians. The party will be around those who have been lost and are now found. Because heaven rejoices at one when 99 solid, stand a long time, faithful Christians are in place. The heavens rejoice at the one who turns, not the 99. And so we as a church are going to be that way. That's been the vision from the get-go, from all the way back to when Jesus told us to go and make disciples of all nations, and then all of his disciples who did that got killed, which isn't too comfortable, which doesn't sound like the perfect church to me, doesn't sound like the easiest lifestyle to me, and yet many, many, many came to know Jesus. This is what we're about. Where the longest serving Christians die to themselves because they understand Jesus. And those who are new get a celebration when they walk in the doors and they come to know the one that we've all learned about. Worship team, you can come on, join up. Today we got cake in the lobby. Cake's nice. I like cake. And we got cake just because we're going to remember, we're going to sort of make a prophetic statement about the way we're going to celebrate those who enter the kingdom, who find Jesus, and who come into this church and maybe don't quite get our culture, but want that Jesus in their life. I want to encourage you, Easter Sunday, we're going to have baptisms. If you've never been baptized, you need to get baptized. If you follow Jesus, you love him, you've given your life to him, now's the time. You should do it. Because I haven't stopped talking about our last baptism, which is part of the reason why you get baptized, so that the rest of the church can be like, yes, look what's going on. And so when I was reading this, I thought, here's what our next baptism service is going to look like. Easter weekend, Sunday morning, it's going to be awesome. We're going to come in here, we'll celebrate the life of Jesus. People are going to get baptized, and I'm going to have noisemakers all throughout this whole place. Yeah. Not joking. Like, I think the kids' craft that week is going to be glitter painting signs that say, welcome home, welcome to the family, welcome to the kingdom of God. This is where life is. This is where death is defeated and life has come. And we're going to, it's just going to be a party. That may have looked bad, but it was like, it's gonna be something like, those are kazoos or noisemakers and things like that. We're going to have party hats. I don't know what we're doing. We're going to have a party here. And we're going to learn how to celebrate those who are far away, those who are distant, a long ways off. We're going to learn how to run towards them rather than figure out how to keep ourselves from them, insulated from them. So if we're going to build a culture that's for them, I want you to, one, learn how to celebrate hard when people come to Jesus. We're going to do that together. Two, serve on team. If you're not serving on team, and then you're not serving people who are not yet here. Jump in on a team. jump in with us. We want to start a parking team. Maybe today someone says, I would like to organize a parking team. I'm very administrative. I'm very capable. I can do this really well and this move well and beep, 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 and I love a fluorescent vest. If that's you, come talk to Pastor George. We'd love to talk about what that could look like if we could do something like that. We need people who are going to run kids sign-in. You think, oh, that's like, I'm not that good with kids. Okay, well, you just have to babysit printers, not kids. So that might be a good fit for you. We need some people who are going to do that. Come serve on team. The third thing, so celebrate hard, serve on team. Third, bridge the gap. The father ran to his son. He said, you're far away. That's going to be a long ways till you get to me. Listen, I'll come to you. And he runs out, sprints across that, like, hey, son, plows him over. I don't know what it looked like. He bridged the gap. Figure out in your life what it would look like to bridge the gap to those who are far away that are in your life, that you know about. And the last one is invite people. Bring them on out. If we all just invited one, say we invited five people this whole year, and we had a 20% success rate, we got one person out, our church would double. It's a pretty good stat. That's worth celebrating. Let's do it. So we're going to have cake. These guys are going to play a fun song. We're going to go, and we're going to be a church that thinks about them, not just us, that creates a culture that's not about protecting what is, but seeking what is not yet. And we're going to believe that God is going to grow this thing. There's no such thing as plateauing as long as we're going. And God's going to do something incredible in the Comox Valley through Northgate Foursquare Church, and every church that decides that they're going to reach the lost and care for those who are broken and bridge the gap and chase after those who are a long way away. Amen? Amen. Let's stand up. These guys are going to sing. We're going to go. It's going to be awesome.